Well, thank you, Gordon, and thank all of you for coming out tonight and sharing in this story. Now, the title of this piece, we should start there. The title is Who Am I Again? And I am Lethan. And what I'm going to do for you tonight, I'm going to share with you a verbal collage of stories about traumatic brain injury, beginning with my story. I was 17 years old, a senior in the small town of Bloomsburg, Pennsylvania, and I was ready to get out of Bloomsburg. I had a plan. I was going to be an actor, study theater in New York or LA or Sheboygan, Wisconsin, or any place that wasn't small town Pennsylvania. And I was at that age where I was having a lot of fights with my parents. I would say things like, Mom, Dad, I don't need you anymore. You are just the weights holding me down, keeping my creative spirit from soaring. I am going to do whatever I want to do, okay? Oh, can I borrow 10 bucks? So that's where I was. That's the setting. The date, November 4th, 1999. It's a little after 7 o'clock in the evening. I'm driving my sister to her school. Her eighth grade class has decided to have a sleepover party at the school, and because I used to attend, I'm elected as the chauffeur. And when I get there, I remember reminiscing with my former French teacher, laughing, getting into my car, waving au revoir. And I remember watching my French teacher through my rearview mirror, waving goodbye as I drove off into the night. Like I said, this is a verbal collage of stories. And while researching this piece, I became involved with the Crumley House, which is a brain injury rehabilitation and living center located in Limestone, Tennessee. And while there, I became acquainted with some of the residents at the Crumley House and got to hear the stories of some of the residents, like Tony and Sarah and Larry. And when Larry's story begins, he was just your average 12-year-old boy. Well, I was a military brat, so I moved around a lot. Base to base to base. And I remember at that age, I was always climbing on things, buildings, rocks, trees. And one day I climbed up just a little bit too high, and for Sarah, it just happened. There was no warning, not really. I was in my car. I had just dropped my daughters off at Little Angel's daycare. I was going through a green light, and boom! Just happened. There was no warning. Tony was involved in a single car automobile accident with his fiance. At least that's what they tell me. See, I don't actually remember the day of the accident itself or the week leading up to the accident, but I remember 10 days previous to the accident. I'm sitting in the kitchen with my fiance and with her mother, and we're making plans for the wedding. The hardest thing that I had to kind of keep relearning as I came back to life after this accident with... I was the only survivor. My mother was in her home office when she got the call. It was late, after 8, I was doing some paperwork when the telephone rang. I answered and learned that my son had been involved in a serious automobile accident. He was in a coma. He had been life flighted to Geisinger Medical Center. And there are moments when the world will freeze. Thoughts, emotions, doesn't make sense. Frozen as you try to comprehend what you just heard. But the world continues to turn, and I needed to tell his father. He was at work, I... put down the phone, collected my things, turned out all the lights, and made sure to take the dog out before I left. I didn't know when I would return. Tony, as we said, doesn't remember the day of his accident, but I do remember waking up at the wheel just before my accident actually happened. See, I remember opening my eyes and seeing the front of my car smashing into that roadside embankment while the back wheels of my car are pushing forward, which pushes the center of my car straight up, which throws me straight up through the roof of my car, straight up into the air, straight up, 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 up a good 2,000-3,000 kilometers. And I remember getting into a long line, but I'm about halfway through, so I don't got too long to wait. And at the front of the line, there's this big man wearing this long white robe. He was strong. He was an angel. And the angel looks at me and he tells me, "It's not my time yet." And I remember falling. Remember feeling the wind rush past my cheeks as I was falling down towards the earth, getting larger and larger in my sight. And I remember slamming into my body. When I woke, I had been in a coma for 6 months. So they got the idea that maybe they could have some sort of prayer service, some event where they could bring the entire community together and everyone could show their love and support and give offers of help, and then they could go away. And so my parents, they spoke with the hospital and were given use of the hospital chapel for one evening, and they did not make a big deal about this at all. They just told a few people at church. They thought word would spread. And the evening of the service came, and the chapel was filled. Extra chairs were brought in. People were standing in the back. And once everyone came in, found a seat or standing a spot somewhere, no one really knew what to do. See, my parents had decided to run this service in the Quaker style of worship. That's where the entire congregation comes together to sit in silence, to pray and meditate and be with one another. And then when someone feels moved by the light, they may stand and share a thought, a prayer, a memory, even a joke, whatever feels appropriate at that time. My parents thought that this would be a good all-inclusive, non-denominational style of worship to include the community, and they were right in theory. Unfortunately, despite the fact that we were living in the Quaker state, the only thing the majority of the people present actually knew about Quakers was they had something to do with oats. And no one really knew what to do. And the service began awkwardly, a little shuffling, a little bit of whispering in the back there. And no one said anything for 35 minutes. My parents were just starting to think that maybe they had made a mistake and maybe they should end the service early, when Susan, a friend I went to elementary school with, suddenly felt moved by the light, and she stood and she shared a memory. And no one remembers what this memory actually was, but what they do remember is that her memory opened up a floodgate and stories began to pour from the congregation. Stories about laughing together, about working together, about parties, about dates, stories about that time we all got naked and went streaking downtown. Oh. They told a few stories I had really hoped my parents would never hear. But people began to laugh, began to smile, and a transformation from a service of sorrows to a celebration of love, of life, and of community. And the next morning, I woke from my coma.